Welcome back. And as with yesterday, I thought to begin with, we'd just have a half an hour or so where any of you that wants to ask anything or say anything, you're very welcome to do that. I wanted to do this partly just to get a sense of one another and help me have a sense of what's going on for you on the retreat. Because unlike in-person retreat, of course, I don't get a chance to talk to people collectively or individually. So that's what we'll be doing. So just raise your electronic hand or whatever it is you do, and say your name, preferably, and whatever you wish to say.
Hi, I seem to be spotlighted, so it's probably me. This is Karen Avacha here, Paramananda.
Hello.
I was on retreat at Vajraloka with you about, I don't know, maybe 5 or 6 years ago, and had some really wonderful interviews, stroke conversations with you. So it's lovely to be here again. I've got a couple of things that I thought I'd quite like to raise. One of them is that we were talking yesterday about, the way our ego appropriates what's going on. And I kind of noticed in the meditation, I had this kind of sense of a kind of flickering between sort of just being with the experience and then appropriating it and then noticing that and then letting go. And it seemed almost to be kind of flickering in between, like from one to the other and back again. And I wondered, got any thoughts about that? It kind of slowed down a bit eventually, but I was kind of quite aware of that. So I wondered anything on that.
Well, I suppose I think the important thing is that you're just aware of it, really, and don't you shouldn't really have the expectation of it not happening, I don't think.
Yeah.
Sometimes, of course, if it doesn't happen, that's great. And if it does happen, you're just aware of it.
Yeah.
I think with all these things, what we're trying to do is to notice what happens and then not compound it,
Yeah, sure.
I think that's it, really. And of course, when it doesn't happen, we don't notice it, if you see what I mean. I don't know about the flickering. I mean, maybe that's how it. I think it does sort of flicker. Yeah, I think that's probably what. Well, one way we experience it. Yeah, but I take it as a good sign that you just notice it. You know what I mean? I think that's the important thing. Or you, it's a sort of feeling, isn't it? In a way, it feels different, doesn't it, when you take hold of something? It's like grasping, isn't
And of course, there's that thing where you kind of have that moment of noticing that you're not appropriating, and then you kind of are, I think that.
it?
Okay.
It was interesting. I mean, I don't know that this is an absolute thing. So in a way, we want to be interested in what's going on, without kind of holding it in a way that tries to. What we're trying not to do is either sort of push away or pull towards. You know what I mean? I was thinking of that Gilchrist thing. I don't know, I'm sure a lot of you have read that master and his MSA. At one point, he talks about reaching out and touching something, doesn't he? And he's saying that when we grasp something, it fires off quite different neural pathways than when we touch something in an exploratory way, We're just interested in it. I think that's so, like when you reach out and you're just feeling something, you just want to take in the sort of feel and shape of something rather than you want to pull it towards you. Maybe that's akin to it in a way, you know, that we're kind of interested in what goes on without wanting to appropriate it or change it, you know, sort of leaving alone. But it's not a turning away, you know what I mean? So it's quite a subtle thing we're trying to do. So I can only imagine that there's lots of different gradations of it. You know what I mean? It's like, yeah. Anyway.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, I mean, I suppose underneath it, you know, there is a craving for the appropriation not to be happening. And that's gonna, I guess,
Well, yeah, well, I might well be, yeah. I mean, it's an endless regress in that way, isn't it? In a sense, you know.
Okay, that's great. Thank you.
You have another thing, is there?
Oh, the other thing was just you said, you said, oh, let the insight look after itself. And I just felt, I thought that, you know, something felt really good about hearing you say that, you know, because some, you know, there's this sort of, you know, there's this big kind of quest after insight, and I don't know, something felt a little bit released or liberated when you said, you know, don't worry about that, just let that, well, that's how I heard it, you know, just let it look after itself, you know.
No, that is what I said. I think that's a, I mean, it relates to what you were saying before, really, that any insight that's, once the craving's come in, you haven't got the insight anymore, have you? So if the craving is, if the insight is appropriated, it's no longer an insight, you know? So we're working with a very paradoxical kind of situation, really. We don't, I mean, the mistake is to think that we have insight. You know, because that's linguistically at least an appropriation, isn't it? And also for most people, a psychological appropriation, isn't it? They feel kind of inflated by the insight, you know.
So it becomes a kind of a selfing thing in a way.
I have insight. I've had these. We shouldn't worry too much about our experiences one way or the other, I don't think. Even on a lower level, if you can use, I don't like that hierarchical kind of level thing. But even if you know you have a big experience when you meditate, well, I think enjoy it and appreciate it, but don't make too much of it one way or the other, really, you know.
Good.
And I do think if there's a stability of mind in love there, I think it will take care of itself. You know, when you have an insight experience, which we all have insight experiences, just that we turn away from them. So the thing is not to turn away from them, you know. Does that make sense, you know?
There's a sense,
It's just our own nature, isn't it? It's seeing into our own nature because our deeper nature is the same as the nature of reality. We're not different from.
I really liked you, just that very succinct thing of saying, you know, steadiness of mind and love. You know, that's just, for me, that's a really nice thing to sort of, yeah, that's, that feels really succinct.
Good, I'll shut up then.
Oh, thank you. It was all really good. Thanks.
Okay, thank you.
And now Marcia has a question.
Hi, Marcia.
Hi, Paramananda. Hi there. Can you hear me? I think I was really struck by what you said, leading through the meditation. You said something like, "There's much better things that we can be doing than thinking in meditation," and it kind of just, it just set me off realizing how much I was thinking and how much I think because I'm at home, once I close my eyes, I'm very aware of sound. Well, I was referring to it before as noise. And I think that there's a part of me that just wants that not to be there. So escaping off into fantasy and sort of thought seems to be a way of distracting from sort of what is just where I am.
Well, I can I ask Marcia, are the sounds unpleasant or what is?
Well, no, when I sat and sort of reflected on it, I just thought it's just the noises of, I mean, it is, I live in quite a busy area. It's just traffic, planes, just outside street noise, really. But I think I associate retreat with quiet, and this is the first time I've sort of done a retreat by myself in my own home. So yeah, I just think I noticed that sort of going off into fantasy in meditation and into thought. And then there was a stage where I sort of realized that and could see, oh, I'm what's actually here is just sound. There's cars, there's people walking by the house. Yeah, and I just it yeah, it just was reminding me of the you said the Jung quote about distraction and neurosis. And I realized outside of the meditation how much, yeah, I was just thinking, gosh, I'm pretty much 90% of the time I'm sort of, yeah, I seem to be distracting myself in some way. Yeah.
Well, you and most of us, I think, to be honest.
Yeah, it's just a yeah. I just thought it was really. It just sort of set something off for me by you saying that. That yeah. I mean, I know on retreat before I've asked you what to look out for, and I was wondering if there's anything you would say, sort of when you're doing a retreat at home in this environment. Are there any tips about what to watch out for?
No. Nothing immediately springs to mind, actually. I don't know quite. I mean, other than what I'm saying anyway, I don't know if there's any special tips. I mean, personally, I mean, I find sound really useful. But of course, some sounds are a bit unpleasant or. I mean, the thing about sound, to say with sound, the great thing about sound is it's happening in the moment. So at least it's in the present moment, you know. And I
Yeah.
think when you notice that you're thinking, particularly if it's a form of distraction, what I would try and do is find the physicality of that rather than the thing about thought, it's kind of abstracted, you know. Obviously, sometimes thinking is great, you know, but because we spend most of our time thinking anyway, it's not really what we want to be doing when we meditate. Because we do enough of that most of the time, you know. So when we're meditating, we're trying to do something a little bit different. And partly what we're trying to find is the basis on which that thought is arising. It's a kind of conceptualization of a feeling or a tension in the body, or this is one way you could look at it. So you notice you're thinking, don't think, stop thinking, because, well, the Zen people say think, not thinking, but don't know how helpful that is. But I say if I'm thinking a lot, I'll try and see if I can find somewhere in the body that feels held, or, you know, that I can relax. What can you relax, you know? That's what I was meaning, really, that rather than thinking, you can just, you know, try and imagine the body opening, or I don't know, any sort of thing, really. Just pay attention to anything, really.
Yeah. Just one other thing, just when with the drumming, I noticed, and the leg releasing in that sit, I did notice my legs quite easily relaxed after not long. But I then realized, you mentioned the sky, and as I went, sort of took my attention more upwards, I realized I was really gripping in the throat and the tongue. And when we were doing the laying down for the drumming, I'd sometimes drift off. And when I'd come back, it's like the drumming brought me back immediately to the throat area. There was some sort of relaxing or some, yeah, I was coming back, but always to the throat, which I just found quite interesting.
What did you make of it?
Sorry?
What did you make of it? What did you think about?
I just thought,
when you say it was interesting, what was going on?
Just I think I've had a lot of when I was a child, I used to get a lot of throat. If I got sick, it would go to my throat. And I just, that area still needs attention. It still needs sort of tending to, I think, is what it made me think. It's still got a tendency to grip or to be sort of not at ease.
Sure, yeah.
But also I enjoyed the fact that it was a medicine Buddha. I don't know, maybe something about that as well felt quite significant. So yeah, really enjoying the drumming though.
Okay, well, thank you, Marcia.
Thanks, Paramananda.
Hello, Divya. Do you want to share?
Thank you. Hi, Paramananda. Thank you for the couple of days so far. I haven't actually brought this question up before, but in a weird way, I feel like it's I don't know. Anyway, so I am not a morning person. And for me, 10 a.m. is quite early. I find it quite difficult to meditate in the morning because this doesn't happen, you know, any other time of the day, but because I find myself drifting in between being awake and almost, you know, nodding off, but I'm sitting up and I'm getting the, like, you know, head bobbing thing. And I was literally just thinking that, you know, normally it almost stops me from trying to meditate in the morning, because I think, well, that's not a valid meditation, because I'm, you know, drifting between being, you know, the conscious mind and the subconscious mind. But then I suddenly thought, oh, well, actually, it's kind of interesting, because I had an experience during the drumming, and I ended up kind of in my head, like, and subconsciously, because I woke up afterwards sort of chanting this quite a shocking thing. And then I get what am I trying to, I guess I'm, I guess I'm trying to ask, is there a way that I can work with that, work with the fact that I'm, you know, struggling to stay awake, rather than think, well, that's not, you know, it's not valid, because I, you know, everything's valid in its own way, isn't it? Yeah.
Hmm. It's interesting what you're saying. In some Tibetan kind of tradition, I've seen films of this. They're in the monastery, they're on their bed, and when the bell goes, they roll out of bed onto a meditation mat and start meditating. And they're quite deliberately trying to keep that kind of hypnagogic state, you know, that not quite awake, not quite asleep. I think the only thing you can do, but it takes quite a lot of practice. Well, you can just stick with it, but I think if you can, I mean, I'm only saying this because it's not very pleasant, is it, when the actual physical, when the heads go, you know?
Yeah.
I think if you try and really keep quite a strong awareness in the posture, sometimes mm-hmm. you can kind of stay with that state without going, I think it is a valid kind of state. I mean, it's kind of what we're, in a way, trying to encourage when I'm getting you to lay down, you know?
Mm.
You know, the positive side of the state is that the ego is more relaxed, you know?
Mm.
So I think you're right. I mean, there's something positive about it, but I don't know any particular other than placing more emphasis on the posture. But yeah, I would try to keep working with it. Yeah, I think, you know, I think some interesting things happen in that kind of hypnagogic area, you know, where we're not quite fully awake but not asleep.
I think when I've tried to work with it, you know, like focusing on my crown chakra, or you know, doing, focusing on the posture of the body, you know, it doesn't matter what I do, I still, you know, it still happens. But I think it's almost like I've kind of had a shift in perspective about it, because I have always seen it as wrong, or, you know, I should be awake and focusing on the whatever it is, you know, the focus of the meditation. But I think thanks for your feedback, and I think what you said about that's kind of the state that you're trying to encourage a little bit in the drumming is actually helpful for me to hear. So yeah, thank you.
I think just to add, I think that's probably a little some, I'm and trying to sort of feel into it, I think there's probably a certain amount of collapse that happens in the spine before the head goes. You know, a bit something, and it might actually be, I mean, I don't know if this would help. It might actually be that you want a little bit more strength in the belly. You could try pushing the diaphragm down slightly. I think the head going is part of, I don't think the head goes without the body having collapsed somewhat. Beforehand. So you might be able to catch it a bit earlier. So rather than thinking about keeping your head from collapsing, maybe try and keep a bit of strength in your belly, below the navel. You know what I mean by that?
I do. And actually this morning I noticed that my spine relaxed, you know, that my body was relaxing, and then that was the last thing to go.
Yeah, the head goes, doesn't it? Yeah. So if you can catch it earlier, that process, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't really matter, other than it can be a bit unpleasant, can't it? That I know I find it quite unpleasant, that nodding thing, you know?
I think it's more the actual fact that I can't stay awake that's unpleasant. But yeah, the bobbing isn't very nice either. But
they say they used to get the monks to meditate on the side of a well.
Oh wow! When
they would go down, and when they opened their eyes, they had this big drop underneath them. Anyway, you can't really do that in your house.
Find something similar.
Yeah, well, funny enough, when in my ordination at Tuscany, we did have a wall which had quite a long drop. It was quite a wide wall, so you could quite easily meditate on it. But it had quite a long drop down the outside of the building, you know? That kept you awake. Anyway, I don't know. But anyway,
I'm actually going to
I don't know where that is. It's there somewhere in the Pali Canon. So at least, you know, you're in a long tradition of, you know, it's a very recognized thing.
Yeah.
And you can get up earlier because it's probably related to when you've got up, isn't it? But you might not want to get up early.
Well, it's actually, I've got a health condition, so I can't, like, I really struggle in the morning, which is also interlinked in the whole. But yeah, I think I will actually, I'm actually going to try that. I'm going to sit really, really far on the edge of my sofa and see what happens.
Okay.
So if I've got my camera on and I disappear, that's where I've gone, on the floor.
Let us know if it works.
I will. Thank you so much.
Okay. Yeah, bye.
Hello, Sarah. Would you like to comment?
Thank you. Yeah, I just had a question, which was, I think this morning you said about something about craving and aversion being in the legs. This is the first retreat that I've been on with you, so maybe that's something that, you know, it's just new to me, and I just wondered if you could say a little bit more about that, about craving and aversion being specifically located in the legs.
Did I say, yeah. I've got two main sources for this, really. One is Hackwin, who's a very well-known kind of historical figure, meditator, who had this experience of alienation. He has a kind of insight experience, and then he goes off and he has this sort of insight experience, and he ends up feeling really alienated, and his Buddhist teachers don't know what to do. Anyway, to cut a long story short, he finds some Taoist guy up a mountain, and he gives them these exercises to do with his legs. That got me interested in legs as a meditator.
Yeah.
And then, of course, more recently, a lot of trauma stuff is located the psoas muscles as the main kind of, I don't quite know how to put it, so I don't want to literalize it too much, but they're talking about trauma being, you know, this idea that trauma is stored in the body.
Yeah.
And it's particularly stored in these psoas muscles that run laterally, don't they? The big muscles, aren't they, that run laterally through the body, the buttocks. So that was another sort of thing. But I mean, basically, I've just found myself these days, because I got very interested in the legs, and because I started working with relaxing the legs as a way of establishing stability of the posture. Experientially, I've noticed whenever I was distracted, there was some holding going on in the leg, or more or less subtle, or more or less, you know, sometimes quite obvious, sometimes quite subtle.
Yeah.
So it might well be, you know, this is the idea. I mean, I don't want you to take these ideas too literally, but this idea that there's a kind of physicality to all of our mental experience, yeah?
Yeah.
And even craving and aversion is actually quite a physical experience, aren't they? Certainly aversion can be a very physical experience. Well, craving can as well. So, and because on another level, craving and aversion is akin to, or another level of, what we call fight or flight. And of course, fight or flight reactions starts in the thighs and down there, you know, when we want to move away from something or move towards. So there's a kind of physiological basis why the legs are very sensitive to this sort of idea of craving and aversion, of wanting to move towards. It's more or less a literal thing, actually, isn't it? It's wanting to move towards or away from, isn't it, on some level? And of course, that involves, maybe if we were quadrupeds, it would be equally in the front legs. But because we've just got one pair of legs, haven't we? It's kind of down there, you know.
It's really interesting. I'm aware sometimes of tension in my forearms, which I guess might be from the same response, but I've honestly never thought about my legs in meditation ever before. So that's really interesting and helpful to have a new
It's all in the leg. Meditation is all like, I mean, I'm saying that, and of course that's not really true, but I think it's a good way of feeling about it. If you get the base of your posture proper, the whole thing will sort of fall into place, you know? If you can release more... The other image we get, this is Hackwin as well. After he had this experience and met this Taoist master, he gave us the image. He said meditation should be like sitting in a warm bath, where the warm water is coming up to your kind of hips, and the bath is full of fragrant flowers and medicinal herbs. So he gives, and that's his image that he gives us for meditation. So you got this image of the lower body being completely relaxed. And somehow when we relax the lower body, it activates the upper body.
Yeah.
So it's the kind of activation, what one's going down and one you know, torsos going up, you know. Yeah. You see it in these pictures of bodhisattvas, actually. There's particular periods in Buddhist art where you get these very narrow-waisted bodhisattvas which like curve in their body. Like, you can see the upper body is kind of opening upwards, where the lower body is like two triangles, more or less, you know.
Yeah.
And the bottom triangle of the legs is sort of releasing down, and the upper triangle of the torso is kind of opening up and out, more or less like a blossoming. I don't know, yeah. These are just images, I don't know, but yeah, legs, yeah.
Yeah, thank you. That's really helpful. Yeah, thanks.
You can't meditate properly without the legs. No.
Great, thank you.
But not properly, you know, not enough attention given to the legs other than all that uncomfortable. But there's a lot more to the legs than that, really.
Yeah, no, that's really helpful.
If you're thinking a lot, that come down into your legs. That's what you need to do. Releasing your legs.
Thank you.
So how are we doing for time?
It's 22:05.
All right, we better leave it there, don't we? Not the Where was there anybody waiting?
Thanks.
No one else.
No, okay. Well, we'll leave it there. Thank you for everybody that's asked and said something. Very nice to hear from you all. All right, we better do a bit of meditation now, haven't we? So get yourselves comfortable as you can. I do want to emphasize with the posture because, you know, some of us are maybe through illness or old age or whatever, might feel that we can't sit properly, but even though I talk a lot about posture, you should understand that the most important thing is the spirit of the posture. Yeah? You're trying to sit with a sense of openness and love. And that's the most important thing. It's your sort of attitude. Yeah. So we talk about the posture, but don't take that too literally, physically speaking. Think about postures expressing the attitude. Anyway, I'm sure I'll say more about that. Right. I'm rubbing my heart area. I was doing that. I'm thinking we should do something around the heart this afternoon to start with. So we're going to start off with a very simple little breathing exercise to help us come into the heart. And then what I'm going to ask you to imagine. Don't worry, you don't have to take all this in really just now. But anyway, we start off with a little breathing exercise. And then I'm going to ask you to imagine saying your name. So it can be any name you want really, whatever name that resonates with you. It might be the name you use every day. Might be a kind of nickname, might be a secret name. If you're ordained or like that, or you've got more than one name, choose whatever name feels most resonant with you. And what we're going to do is we're going to imagine our name sounding in our heart. Just the name. And we're going to try and imagine it in a voice in of unconditional love. Yeah. So we're just going to ourselves. I mean, you can say it out loud, of course, because you're at home. And if you, you know, you're muted, so nobody else will hear you. So if you want to say it out loud, that's even better, really. Imagine it. Imagine it coming from the heart. You just say your name. Or you don't have to say it out loud, but let's say, if you want to try saying it out loud. And we're just imagining the voice being said with unconditional love, okay? Your name spoken with unconditional love. Keep saying this word unconditional, unconditional, yeah? So we're not, there's no argument about it, yeah? It's just in the moment your name said with unconditional love. And it might be in your own voice, or it might be in another voice. Just see what happens. But that, we'll just do that. But first of all, we're just going to connect with the heart. So let's start with the posture. Well, let's start with the world around us. Just being aware of the world around you and see if you can just relax. And maybe there's a bit of noise going on. Just let it be. Just let it help you be present. You don't have to make anything of it. Just happens, doesn't it? Arises and passes away in the moment. Let's go down into your base of your posture, talking a little bit about the base and wisdom. Just use those sensations in your buttocks and in your legs. Have a felt connection with what you're sitting on, and then imaginatively, you can also have a sense of the earth spreading out under you, holding you. Spreads out into your room, into your neighborhood, into your country, through your city or town, into what's beyond. We allow ourselves to imagine things as they are. We're sitting in and on the world. Of course, the earth, in a way, planet Earth, goes down below you, thousands of miles. That has a molten iron core. The planet itself is kind of alive, isn't it? With its tectonic plates that shift around, its oceans, its magma, its fiery iron heart. Around you is the immediate landscape. Maybe it's mainly houses. Hopefully there's a few plants and trees. Maybe you're living somewhere a bit more rural. Anyway, you can let yourself have a sense of your surrounding. You can go out as far as you like, really. And above you, you've got this sky, which might be clear or cloudy, light or dark. One of the things we're trying to encourage through meditation is this sense of being connected with the rest of life, the world. And we start by just taking a bit of time to allow ourselves to feel we're in a world, we're in the room that we're sitting in, we're in the town, we're in the country, sitting on this earth with this sky above us this time. Noises arising in the world around us, as well as noises arising in our own body. There's our psyche, but there's lots of psyches probably nearby. Animals, people, all that have some kind of psyche. Maybe even the plants and the trees have some kind of psyche. What we naturally used to believe, I think, most indigenous or ancient cultures felt that all living things had some sort of psyche, some kind of spirit. We find out more and more how incredibly adaptive and communicative trees and fungi and all these things seem to be cooperating, or supporting, or interacting. Maybe it's not so fanciful to think that they had some kind of psyche, some kind of soul. Anyway, a sense of ourselves in the world, as belonging to the world, as a part of an expression of the world, or even the universe expressing itself as you. What a strange and mysterious idea. The universe expressing itself as you. Reality expressing itself as you. Not something outside of you to be found. Something inside of you to be relaxed into, as it were. Relax into reality simply by relaxing into your own experience, your own body, your own heart. Heart being the kind of center where many traditions have imagined the heart, mind, the psyche, the soul. Let's find our natural breath, our natural in and out breath. And we're going to add a kind of imaginal breath to synchronize with our normal in and out breathing. As we breathe in, we're going to imagine also breathing in a subtle breath into the back of the heart. As we breathe out, breathing out this subtle breath through the front of the chest, at the heart center there. And breathing it in through the front, and out through the back, in through the back, out through the front. We're imagining this sort of subtle energetic breath. At the heart center, kind of crossing. We've got one kind of a horizontal breath, isn't it? Which is timed by the vertical breath. Do this quite kind of playfully, it's just a way of coming into our heart area. Breathing in through the back, out through the front, in through the front, out through the back. We breathe out and in from the same side. Your face relax as you do this. Not something you can do wrong or right, it's just a way of imagining the heart area. So just notice what's happening, just trying to, you need to, just gently coming back to just breathing in through the heart center, in and out through the heart center. Might have totally made this up, but I seem to remember in some systems the animal associated with the heart is a deer. Maybe I've just made that up. If I can look it up, but I think the deer might be associated, the animal deer might be associated with the heart. And what we're going to do is just imagine our name spoken or imagined in the heart center. We're kind of listening for our own name called with unconditional love. See what you can make of it, just in a playful way. What does your name sound like if it was called from your heart? Unconditional love. when you've had enough of calling your name, just let it fade away and just sit with the breath and the body and the world. Allowing yourself to feel the interchange, this breathing in of the world into the inner world, and this breathing out from the inner world to the outer world. It's just this visceral, physical feeling of being connected with everything that lives on this planet, the ocean, the plants, the animals, the other people, all of us sharing this breath in one way or another. Green planet, like a blue pearl that lives in space. Breathing planet, this intimacy we have with it every time we breathe in, every time we breathe out. Taking it into our very blood, into every cell of our body. Really isn't that different from being inside our mother's womb, inside the atmosphere of this planet. Provides everything we need to live, doesn't it? Our food, our clothes, our housing, our friends, and our breath. Have a sense of sitting with these people, breathing in with them, breathing out with them. Even though we're all over the place, aren't we? Feel into the loving affirmation of just breathing in and out. Affirms us as part of this world. My soft and softening face, if you can. the last few minutes, just keeping the posture, just relax any effort at all. Just keep the posture. We're not trying to do anything. Going to have a little lay down, so make this transition as calmly as possible. No drumming this time, just lay down as well. So just transition into your resting posture as calmly as possible. And just have a little rest. Make sure you're warm enough laying in bed. So, in your own time, calmly as possible, just coming back to your sitting. So we're having a fairly short meditation, 25 minutes. So, just get yourselves, take your time to get yourselves comfortable. Establish the posture as best you can. So just sitting with the breath, the heart and the world. Just see what you can make of simple instructions or suggestions, even. Not really instructions, are they? Just sitting with a sense of yourself, your breath coming and going in your body, in the world. Imagining the heart as the center of this open awareness. The breath naturally takes us down to the heart as we breathe in. Naturally kind of releases the heart as we breathe out. Soft base. just noticing where your attention is. If there's any awareness with the breath and the heart. Of yourself in the world rather than kind of disappearing into a kind of mental realm. Being the kind of energetics of the world. Includes everything really, the whole of you. Your thoughts and your fantasies are still part of the energetics of the world. You don't have to repress anything, we just open out a little bit. Keeping the posture, just slowly kind of relax any effort you're making. So we're just relying on the posture and the breath. It's a breathing posture, isn't it? just bring the meditation to a close in your own time, no rush. We'll leave the session quietly this afternoon.